Good afternoon, everyone. I know it's been a very long, tiring afternoon, so I don't want to take much of your time, and I definitely do not want to stress upon a lot of technical jargons. I mean, AI is one of them, artificial intelligence, machine learning, natural language processing, data sets, algorithms. These are a few technical jargons that are now very evident and very common in today's startup ecosystem. A lot of healthcare analytics, a lot of healthcare startups are working in all of these domains and trying to solve healthcare challenges. So if I have to begin with, if I have to start and make you understand that what is artificial intelligence, let's not go into healthcare as of now, but if you want to understand, does artificial intelligence mean that it has to replace a human? The way I think, can that be simply put into instructions into a computer, and can a computer think the way a human does? Till now, it isn't possible. We are evolving to that stage where a human, where a computer can think based on the set of instructions that we have encoded in. It's like an if and else loop, continuous if and else loop with thousands of iterations going on inside the computer, analyzing stuff, but still the intuition, the cognitive abilities, the processing that we gain from our individual experiences every day, the learning, that effect has to come into a artificial system or a computer or a data set, and that is where artificial intelligence comes into play. That day, say you are a plethora, five doctors are sitting on a case, medical case, and are deliberating between themselves that what should be the, based on these symptoms, what should be the kind of treatment, does the patient possess a very serious threat, is it an immediate or primary care? So how can we expand that treatment from five doctors to 5,000 doctors? Or how can we get the inputs of not 5,000 doctors, of 10 patients who are suffering from the same disease but has been diagnosed with 20,000 doctors across the world? That is where artificial intelligence would come into play, where you get all those data sets, all those numbers, all those crunching algorithms, where the doctors do not have to take the decision themselves. It does not has to be my way or the highway. It is a clinically driven process where all, based on algorithms and data sets, the intuition, the computers are crunching the numbers, the computers are able to decipher what is right, what is wrong. So when you mimic the human function, when computers can learn from experience, when can they solve complex problems like human do, can probably react quickly, you know, in terms of emergency situations. You would not wait for a computer to actually tell you that, do you have to give a CPR? Do you actually have to intubate the patient? What do you need to do? Pictorially, something which we feed the data into computer into numerical bits and pieces, ones and zeros. But can computer really understand image capturing? What we perceive through our own eyes, can computers see the same way that we do? The way we see a heart or a brain or a spinal cord or any other organ of the body, the computer has to understand the same form of image as what we do. That is where we need to evolve our technological systems. We are right now at a later stage where we have been able to give computer a little bit knowledge about what image processing is, how to collaborate the image, how to do eye detection. But there are a lot of use cases, telemedicine, remote monitoring, healthcare analytics, where artificial intelligence can come into play and can help overcome all these challenges. Can the quintessential question, would doctors be required at the end of the day, or there are certain diseases or certain symptoms where computers can actually tell you that, yes, this is not an emergency, you should stay at home, there's nothing wrong with you. If you have had a road accident, but you are at a stage that you don't need to rush to a hospital, or you're fine, you're not suffering. Or in the other way, there has been a road accident and you're suffering from brain tumor. You need to, you have a hemorrhage, you have to go right in right now. That is the use case where human intervention has to go away and the computers or artificial intelligence comes in. But for that, the computer has to become a human. Or the computer has to think the way a human does. The computer has to process those images. The computer has to determine what factor is important, what is not important. It has to understand. It has to be evolved, be intuitive. That is where we have to go. So if I have to describe AI, it has to be, first of all, descriptive. It understands the situation. It could then be prescriptive. Okay, so this is your problem. The computer has understood. Based on that, let us prescribe you that you are suffering from, I have listed down the symptoms, headache, stomachache, vomiting. Based on algorithm, the computer suggests that you could either be suffering from this and you should take a paracetamol or aspirin, say, for example. But you have to evolve from that, from descriptive to prescriptive. We have to go until predictive. That, if I have that, can my family members also, since it's an airborne thing through which I could contaminate my family, or kuch bhi, or it could be that we could spread, it could be a communicable disease, and instead of predicting that there are these chances that you'd have to evolve, that is where artificial intelligence and natural language processing comes into play, that we are evolving what could be. I want to take a very recent example of, say, Ebola. When Ebola struck, millions of dollars of pharmaceutical money was pumped into for finding the right disease, for the right finding the right medicine, or the by pharmaceutical companies, what could be done to stop it, what could be. If artificial system was evolved in a way that they could have understood the Ebola symptoms, and if they could have gone through the hundreds and thousands of medicines already existed, they could have probably found out certain medicines, which was later found out after years of research, that there were two medicines which were already existing, which could have stopped Ebola's gradual expansion plan within one day. Giving that medicine would have actually stopped Ebola from spreading like a wildfire and would have contained it. But all this was not possible because our systems hadn't evolved. The data wasn't there. The analysis from Ebola symptoms at multiple places, into different demographies, into different different geographies, was not even able to capture. So an AI system is only as good as our technological systems can play. Precursor to that, I mean, any AI system, I'm telling you right now, would only be helpful if we have our basic EHR systems, EMR systems already in place. Unless we move from that manual to a technological aspect where we stop, where the intelligence gathering is being done in a system, we will not be able to evolve that. So first and foremost, we need to evolve our IT systems into a very short play, that each symptom, each prescription, each consultation, each description is embedded into the system. After all that is done, the AI can do its job. The AI can probably, as we are making it think like a human doctor does, or like a human does, would actually come out with prescription analysis. You would not need to second guess yourself. And frankly speaking, AI is nothing new. It has been existing from 1970, 75. There have been examples of AI where in Boston or in Cleveland Clinic or in Mayo, there are doctors actually put the symptoms into the system, and they give a prescriptive model that, yes, the patient could be suffering from them. It's a basic form of AI. To think about IBM Watson, which is one of the prime examples of AI, that how a computer can think like a human and play chess and defeat our world grandmaster. This was done in 97. So a good 21 years ago, AI had evolved more. It could think faster. It could think into more computations and permutations. It could actually think and predict what our world chess champion could do and defeat it. So we have already done that when the board is already set, or when the parameters are a little less. But now, in terms of healthcare, which is a wide parameter based, which is demographically and pandemically has different capabilities and abilities, we have to come together to solve that challenge of how, even in India itself, a lot of diseases such as tuberculosis, diabetes, can be moved away if we have those data sets and information into play. So if you see through this diagram, artificial intelligence does not just mean one aspect of it, that you, if you're collecting data, it is about collecting data, processing that data, the data learning from itself, that if a person was suffering from this disease, did the temperature increase from 102 to 102.5? If it did not, did it decrease based on paracetamol, aspirin, or any other drug? If that was there, what could be the other factors? Did the prescriptions again increase? And all this, except just by feeding data, would not be helpful until, I'm mentioning it again, until the vision capturing or until the image processing is complete. How do we say that it is through our own eyes that we can judge and understand? So until the computer's camera can become like a human camera or can see through the human eyes, artificial intelligence would not evolve to a human level. So in a nutshell, an AI system has to evolve and has to have, from image processing to learning systems to natural language processing to neural network, it has to be like a human brain working on faster than a human brain. We have already solved that problem of how it can compute faster. But can it think like a human is the real question. These are certain examples of how artificial intelligence has been in the past in terms of games, expert systems, natural languages, neural networks, robotics. And as I said earlier, so these are something which has been existing for a long time. Let me now want to see that, where do you think AI can be evolved into healthcare? It's been used in other places. Say about medical records and one thing. Our few of the healthcare systems are already in place where we are capturing data in terms of electronic health records and something. But through AI, we have to do that faster, quicker, consistent, and trace each and everything easily. That is one thing, one application of AI. Another application of AI would be, do you actually need to call the doctor up and again that I have done a CT scan again, I've done an X-ray again, I've done an MRI again. Do you want to see the difference? An AI can see those image recognition again, can see those data points, can actually tell you better than a human eye could perceive, based on exact measurements of, say, even 0.1 micron difference between a neuron network or not through in an MRI. That is where AI should be represented, in where you need to do continuous image analysis again and again. So remove the human intervention in that. Get machine learning and try and understand that how that arduous task or how the time-consuming task is replaced from a very simple uploading an image through your mobile phone and getting the result within probably in a fraction of a second, or say even in 2 seconds. How do you say that we can use each individual treatment path is different? If I am suffering from fever, so the common process is to probably take a paracetamol. That may necessarily not be my case. It could be different for a 30-year-old, a 40-year-old, a 50-year-old. But from a doctor's perspective, if you're suffering from fever, take a medicine. More the input, the AI system can help you understand what and how and where is your system, how your system is going to react differently to a normal medicine or prescription. Another use is digital consultation, which has been stalked. It has already started. A lot of startups are working in India, US, abroad. One of the startups in UK, Babylon, it uses, not only if you speak into a microphone like I am doing right now, it will analyze my speech. It will try to understand if I have a throat infection, if I'm stammering a little, if I'm stuttering a little. So that is the level that probably you don't need to go yourself to a doctor. You speak into your phone, it analyzes your normal speech patterns. Obviously, that data has to be there between in the hand. It will compare your normal speech to your speech right now. And if you have put in that, yes, you're feeling a little bit nauseatic, dizzy and something, that digital consultation can actually tell you that you might be suffering from a big throat infection. Do you need to do something or not about that? Digital consultation is one very important fear. As I think our previous speakers already told about a lot of stuff that the doctors suffer from, nurse problems, there is staff problem. How can human intervention go away from digital consultation to virtual nurses? You do not need to go to the hospital. Probably that's not a good point for us doctors, but down the line, when we are evolving into that technological age where your nursing staff, your virtual nurses or virtual doctors in itself can give you or predict or tell you that there are certain things you can do at home, they have that much data, that much capability. And this data is not from one location. These are probably hordes of pages, millions of data points already on the internet, all the research papers that have been published. You can crawl all that data, put it into a system, analyze it, decipher it, comprehend it, and then suggest. That is where a virtual doctor or nurse comes into play. All that information is just lying there through AI, through neural networks. We are trying to understand it and give you. I have a lot of friends in the startup industry. So one of the examples quoted was that someone's mother was suffering from Schrodinger's disease. But the symptoms, they went to one doctor, second doctor, 10, and even after 10 doctors, they were not able to do that. Through an app that they created, in which they have probably articulated or got a lot of data from the internet, once you fill in the symptoms from whatever the lady was suffering, the app had predicted a 12% probability of Schrodinger's, what probably 10 doctors couldn't. So I'm not being biased about what doctors could do or can't do, it's just that data can be useful and can be analyzed, and even a flicker of hope that 12% some disease, Schrodinger disease, which was not being able diagnosed by a doctor, can help and easily able to detect something which would have been detected probably down the line 2 or 3 years. So the other usages of AI is again into the medication management. So I don't want to keep on iterating in the fact that any technology is a boom for us right now. We can use AI or as a technology, whatever we are doing manually, AI or machine learning would be able to do it better, would be able to do it faster, would be able to give us better results if and only if we adopt technology. And that can be for all the participants. It's not only for patients itself, it's for hospitals, it's for clinicians, it's for paramedical staff, it's for medical insurance. One of the other examples is pharmaceutical companies. The recent example that I took about Ebola was also that if they could have scanned the existing medicines and put the symptoms that Ebola had given, probably they would have found that there are certain medicines that already exist that could stop the widespread of the disease. So you adopt the technology, and this technology is for everyone. They are in form of your wearables. Everybody has a Fitbit today, an Apple Watch, a Samsung Watch. This is nothing, just AI. Obviously, how do you make it more intelligent? How do you make it understand the way a human does? If you're running and your heart rate would shoot up till 150, 160. So that's not a panic attack. That is something which you're doing. So a wearable device, when it becomes an AI, would be when you're sleeping and your heart rate shoots up till 160, 170, or you're about to have a cardiac arrest. That is where artificial intelligence has come into play. It has been monitoring you. It understands your life cycle. It understands that right now you are in a static state, but something is going wrong in your body. Your blood pressure is increasing, your cholesterol levels are decreasing, your heart rate is increasing. That is where wearables as an artificial intelligence device would kick into play. Right now we are in a rudimentary form of just collecting information. My wearable device can only right now tell me a few parameters from my heart rate to my blood pressure to other things. But we evolve into an AI system when we feed it data and tell it to analyze or give us. I'm very sure down the line in future, and that down the line is not very far, my friends, probably 5 to 7 years, you will even have wearable devices which would probably have a 0.5 cc of Epi or some sort of injectable right now in there, which would actually automatically even inject you with the treatment based on that symptoms. That is down the line. People, I know pharmaceutical companies which are researching into this. So, health monitoring, as I said, and last and foremost, that any AI system or any machine learning system or any natural language processing system, they are as good as the innovation or as the human feeds into. The more data we have, the more understanding and the more knowledge that we provide, the better result, the better analysis, the better comprehension of what we suffer from and how we can improve ourselves better. That is what artificial intelligence is all about. It's just us in a faster, better, quicker, and a more probably desktop way, a computerish way. Thank you.
So thank you so much, Dr. Saarthak Bakshi. I would like to call, invite Mr. Love Bhardwaj to please come up on the stage and give the certificate to Dr. Saarthak Bakshi.